Welcome back. In this video and the coming videos, I will be explaining how artificial neural networks work. I will begin by explaining the perceptron. This will take me about 2 videos, and then I'll show you some Java implementation of the perceptron just to make sure that things make sense, and after that we'll move on to more complicated architectures. If you remember from previous videos, we've covered all of these classifiers and now we are here. Now, some biological background. An artificial neural network is a complicated system, not complicated really, the biological one is complicated by the way, is a system that's based or inspired by the biological neural network such as the brain. So the brain has approximately 100 billion neurons and they communicate through electrochemical signals. So the neurons are connected through junctions called synapses and they communicate through these signals. Each neuron receives thousands of connections with, you know, other neurons, and they constantly receive incoming signals to reach their cell bodies. Now, if the resulting sum of the signals is above a certain threshold, then a response is sent through the axon. Notice now we have a sum, so it's understood that the neuron, the biological neuron, sums up the signals and it checks them against a certain threshold and it sends a response accordingly. So focus now on the concept of summing signals and comparing them to, against a threshold. The artificial neural network, it tries to create the computational mirror or computational equivalent of a biological neural network, although that's not 100% possible at the moment because the real network, for example the brain, is too complicated for our current day computers. Although it's not comparable, since the number of number and complexity of neurons used in biological neural networks is many times more than those used in an artificial neural network. So just an effort, but it really works well. It makes sense, and hopefully after my explanation and after you having a look at my source code, you will develop a good understanding at least of the neuron, the most basic unit of our subject at the moment. So the perceptron, which is an artificial neuron, it models a neuron, it receives n inputs, maybe corresponding to features or to input variables from our data. It sums those inputs, so it just adds them to each other. It checks the result and produces an output, checks the result, i.e. compares it to a certain threshold maybe, and then produces an output. Usually it's used for linearly separable classes, if you remember from before, and for binary classification. So remember, we have 2 linearly separable classes, maybe red class, blue class, and we want to find a straight line, any straight line that perfectly separates the 2 classes. Focus on any straight line. We can have an infinite number of lines, one of them, any one of them is enough. So if you focus here, we have input. By the way, each input will have its weight, so we have weighted inputs. These are just typically real values. We multiply them by each other and we together them. So summation of I equals 1 to n, these are the number of inputs, wixi, that is summation. I know my handwriting is dreadful. So that's the summation, and then we pass them on to a transformation function that's like a threshold, and then according to the threshold, according to the comparison we do here, whether it's greater than or maybe less than a certain threshold, we produce an output. Let's move on to a bit more detail of how it works. So the perceptron, it consists of weights, summation, processor, and an activation function. The activation function is the one that does the thresholding. A perceptron takes a weighted sum of inputs and outputs, one if the sum is greater than some adjustable threshold value, theta, let's assume, 0 otherwise. In some explanations, you might find it plus 1 and minus 1, and you might find the sine function and as input to it is the summation. Just another way, and simpler way of explaining it. So we have the weighted sum, w1x1 plus w2x2 plus da da da. Are they over than theta, the threshold? If yes, then the output is 1, otherwise the output is no. Inputs and connection weights are typically real values. Now, we actually have another input called the bias. Apart from the weights, we have another input called the bias. And it's normal to treat the bias as just another input, so we can add it to our summation. just always remember that for the bias we will have an input value of 1, so 1 times the bias is the bias, and that's why we can include it in the summation. So w0 now is the bias and x0 is 1. We just formulate it like that so we can again use it in the summation. Notice now we start at 0, not 1 as we've seen previously. Now the bias, the purpose of the bias is it allows us to shift the transfer function curve horizontally to the left or to the right along the input axis while leaving the shape unaltered. If you remember the equation of a straight line before, the bias is like the intercept. The weights now determine the slope of our line. So if we see our line here, the weights determine the slope of the line, and the bias will help us move to the left and to the right so we can find the right line that separates our classes. If you remember the equation of a straight line, y equals mx plus b, x is our input. Now we have one input. Now we're trying to find this line, then m is the slope, y, b is the intercept. The weights now, we'll have one weight for one input, that's like the slope of the line. And we said here we assume there is another input, but the value of that input is 1, so we only want to guess the value of b, which is equivalent to the bias. See, this is from Math is Fun, this picture here. Now we mentioned summation and then the transformation function, the thresholding. The transfer function, what it does, it translates the input signals to output signals. It uses a threshold to produce an output. So we have some value threshold, and we have four types of transfer functions. The unit step or the threshold is just a fixed threshold value. If the output is larger than that value, then it can be 1, otherwise is 0. It's just a simple threshold. Another one is the sigmoid, which is quite popular. Sigmoid function consists of, as you see, that's the function f of x equals 1 over 1 plus e to the power minus p beta x. It has consists of two functions, logistic and tangential. The values of a logistic function range from 0 and 1, and the tangential function, the values range from minus 1 plus 1. And then we have a piecewise linear function where the output is proportional to the total weighted output. And then we have a Gaussian function. I just wanted you to know about this. Now, usually what we do is we have our input data, we know their classes, and we start with a random line, and then we start to check whether the line perfectly separates those inputs, those points, our training set. If yes, then that's the line we're looking for. If not, then we try to move the line to the left or to the right and change the slope. To the left or to the right, that's the bias. We change the value of the bias, and the slope, that's when we change the weight. So you can think of it as if we want to have a line and we want to check if we have a new input point. We want to check which side of the line does that point appear. Which side of the line? Does it belong to this class or this class? So on this side or on this side of the line that separates the two classes. Now, speaking about changing bias and weights, we need to be familiar with something called the learning rate. The learning rate is used to control how much we change the bias and the weights. So we'd like to update the weights and bias in order to get a smaller error to find our separation line or separation plane or hyperplane, depending on the dimensionality of our data. The learning rate will help us control how much we change the weight and the bias. So if you think of it, let's assume this is the value of the error and this is the value maybe of our weight, or how much we change, or the time we spend. So if we change, if we update the weights with time, the error will decrease, and then it may start increasing, and we're looking for the point where the error now is there. So there's no change. That's why that's why people use the derivative when they do the theory of neural networks, because the derivative gives us the rate of change. How much change do we have? And we want a learning rate small enough to assist us find that point where change is zero, so there's no error. Yes, the change is zero. So in plain English, let's say we have in variables or in inputs or in features in our data, normally numerical data, then we need to find n plus 1 weight values, because we have n variables, so we want n weight for them and 1 for the bias. Remember that we said we can have an input for the bias, but the value of that input is 1. And these will be the coefficients in our equation of our line or plane or hyperplane, depending on the number of few features or variables. Just an example, let's say we have 4 inputs. The equation becomes W0 X0 plus W1 X1 W2 X2 plus W2 X3 W4 X4 equals 0. So that's the equation of our hyperplane. Data is 4-dimensional. W0 is X0, that's the bias. So the value of X0 is 1, and we want to find W0. That's why I say here, which is equivalent to W1 X1 all the way to W4 X4 plus B. So B is same as W0 X0, because again, X0 is 1. So WI is the weight of input I, and B is the bias, W0 with input value X0 of 1. Now I'm going to stop it. In the next video, I'll speak more about training in perceptrons, and in the video after that, I'll show you a nice Java implementation of perceptrons for you to understand how they exactly works. Hopefully when you see the code, everything will make sense and things will be much easier to understand. Thanks very much for watching, and I'll see you in my next video.